talks about what the pancreas is and what it does, what are the signs and symptoms of pancreatic cancer, what are your risk factors for getting pancreatic cancer, how do we diagnose it, and how do we treat it. Next slide, please. So the pancreas is located in your abdomen, right behind the stomach, more on the left side, and it's surrounded by all the other organs, the liver, the stomach, the spleen, small intestine. So it's kind of pushed to the back, which comes into play when we talk about symptoms and diagnosis, because it becomes really hard to get symptoms early on, so diagnosis is often delayed. And if you look at the pancreas on the right side there, it shows you what are the different parts of the pancreas. It has the head, which is close to where the intestine is, the middle part called the body, and then the tail, which is closer to the end of the pancreas near the spleen. Next slide. And the main job of the pancreas is to collect secretions and put it into your small intestine so it can help digest your food. And it also combines with the bile, and that also helps digest your food. Next slide. So if you look more closely at the structure of the pancreas, there's two types of cells in the pancreas. One is called the exocrine cells, and that's more, helps with digestion, and they produce all the juices that help in digesting all the food. The second part is the endocrine part of the pancreas, and these produce hormones. And the various hormones are usually insulin and glucagon, which help regulate your blood sugar levels. And so diabetes can often be a sign of pancreatic cancer, because if those cells don't secrete insulin, then your blood sugar can go up. So this is going to come into play when we talk about the types of pancreatic cancer, because there's two types. And the most common type arises from these gland cells that help digest your food. So the exocrine pancreatic, what we call adenocarcinoma of the pancreas. So most often when we're talking about pancreatic cancer, we're talking about adenocarcinoma of the pancreas. Sometimes people can also get cancer that arises from the cells that secrete the hormones, and those are called neuroendocrine tumors of the pancreas. And they're much rarer. And those often cause symptoms much earlier. We tend to pick those up better, but a vast majority of the time when we talk about cancer of the pancreas, we're talking about adenocarcinoma of the pancreas. Next slide, please. And so this explains the two endocrine functions and the exocrine functions. Next slide. So why are we talking about pancreatic cancer today? So going back to Dr. Page's talk as well, if you looked on that diagram, you would see that even though it's not the most common cancer, it's about 6 or 7 on the list of cancers, but it is one of the most deadliest forms of cancer as well. It is number 4 as far as causes of death from cancer. So 9 out of every 100,000 people will be diagnosed with this, and if you look, the same amount of people are going to pass away from cancer of the pancreas in that same time period. The incidence is far greater in males than females. So it's about 2 times common in males than females, and particularly in African Americans than Caucasians. If you look at the number, it's 14.8 per 100,000 people in African Americans as compared to just 8 per 100,000 in the general population. Next slide, please. Now, why is this incidence so high in this particular racial group? There's various theories saying one of them is cigarette smoking. So the good thing is that has kind of come down over the last 20 years or so, and rates are similar. The other risk factors are diabetes. With higher rates of diabetes, all that inflammation in the pancreas tends to lead to a higher risk of getting cancer there. Also, the differences in seeking care, paying attention to symptoms and going to the doctor, all of those differences contributed to this higher rate of pancreatic cancer in African Americans. Next slide. As far as what causes cancer, if you look at the basic level of what causes cancer, and this is the same for any type of cancer, there's some sort of damage that happens to our DNA. We can be born with that damage to our DNA, either inherited from our mom or dad. The second thing is we can do something that can cause damage to the DNA, like smoking. Or sometimes, even though you do everything right, chance plays a hand, and there is a mutation, and you get cancer. So, and that's unfortunate. Next slide, please. So what are the other risk factors that we know about that we can do something about as far as risk, pancreatic cancer goes? One is cigarette smoking. It almost doubles the risk of pancreatic cancer. And the very nice thing is that when they observe people who quit smoking, that risk significantly drops. Mm-hmm. So it really is a preventable cause of pancreatic cancer. As we age, that chance of something happening when our DNA is copied again and again increases. So as you age, the risk of cancer increases. And that's similar for all types of cancer, because when you're copying something 100 times, you're more likely to make a mistake. So as you age, the risk of something going wrong increases. Mm-hmm. Like I said, it's more common in African Americans. And we talked about all those factors that go towards that. It's also more common in men than in women. And some of this, again, may go along with dietary habits and smoking and those kind of things. Another risk factor is chronic pancreatitis. And you can get chronic pancreatitis from gallstone disease, you can get chronic pancreatitis from alcohol consumption, and sometimes just being obese can cause chronic pancreatitis. Mm-hmm. And whenever there's inflammation in that area, it increases your risk of getting cancer in that area. The next one is diabetes. And so this also, because of the same thing, they're not clear what exactly about diabetes it is that increases your risk, but the longer duration of having diabetes does increase your risk of pancreatic cancer. And sometimes, like I said, diabetes can be a sign of pancreatic cancer, because so much of the pancreas is taken over by cancer cells that it stops producing that insulin and your blood sugar starts going haywire. Obesity is also a risk factor. It's been estimated that 8% of the cancers are related to obesity. And along with that goes diet. So anything that's high in cholesterol, high in fried foods, high in meats, increases your risk. Whereas a diet that's high in fruits and vegetables and fiber does reduce your risk of pancreatic cancer. And lastly is genetics. There's a lot of syndromes that have been described that also increases your risk of pancreatic cancer. We've all heard of the BRCA gene that increases breast cancer risk. BRCA2 also increases your pancreatic cancer risk. There are some syndromes which increases colon cancer risk and also tie in with pancreas, like Lynch syndrome, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. So all of these also increase your risk of pancreatic cancer. Next slide, please. So what are the signs and symptoms? What should you be looking for? The most common one that we hear a lot is vague pain. So either in your abdomen, going to your back, and also weight loss, unexplained weight loss. You've not been trying to lose weight, but you still lose weight. That's not a good thing. New onset diabetes can be a symptom of it. And just generalized fatigue, not feeling well, depression, all of these. The other ones are when that tumor presses against your bile duct, then you can get jaundice and yellow discoloration of the eyes. That's a pretty ominous one, because that tells us that it's grown big enough to be pushing on other organs in that area. Next slide, please. Now, like we said, those are the signs and symptoms of the most common one, the pancreatic adenocarcinoma. There's also another type called a neuroendocrine tumor, and these are more symptomatic because they secrete hormones, and those hormones cause various problems. So if you're having excess insulin, you tend to get very low blood sugars and faint from that, get lightheaded, sweating, anxiety, so it usually comes to attention a lot quicker. When you have the opposite of that, which is a glucagon, where you're secreting excess levels of the glucagon, the blood sugar goes super high. So there you get excess thirst, excess urination, and diarrhea from that. So similar to that, most of these cause diarrhea, weight loss, and sometimes ulcers and so forth. Next slide. So how do we find these cancers? So there are certain blood tests to look for that. One is your liver test to see if there's an abnormality in the liver test, and we start going and looking for what's causing that. There is a tumor marker level, like the PSA that we use for the cancer of the pancreas, that's called a CA19-9. Unfortunately, that's not a very good screening test, so we only use it when we suspect cancer to see if it's elevated. That gives us another clue that there's something going on, but we don't routinely check that in everybody. The most effective way to find it is actually through radiology or scans of some kind. So either a CAT scan, an MRI scan, or a PET scan, and that's going to tell us where the pancreas the problem is. And then usually we get a diagnosis by doing something called an endoscopic ultrasound, which allows us to get a biopsy, and then a pathologist will look at the biopsy and tell us, okay, we see cancer cells in this area, and that's how we come to the diagnosis. And that's kind of where we come into play as gastroenterologists, is doing that endoscopic ultrasound and getting the biopsy so we can find the cancer. Next slide. how we do an endoscopic ultrasound is how we do an endoscopy. The patient is sedated and we pass a scope, which is basically a tube with a camera, and it goes into the stomach. And if you look at the picture, you can see how the pancreas rises right behind it. So sitting in the stomach, we can get very good pictures of the pancreas, as opposed to when you're doing an ultrasound from on top of the belly or a CAT scan. It has to go through all the layers that we showed in that first picture. It has to go through your belly, it has to go through your intestine, and all of the air and stuff, and that can sometimes make it difficult to interpret pictures of the pancreas. So when we're that close to the pancreas and sitting in the stomach, we can sometimes even see cancers that they don't see on a CAT scan. So we can pick up lesions very early when we do this endoscopic ultrasound. And through that scope, we also have the ability to do a biopsy while watching under the vision of that ultrasound. So we can get a very directed biopsy of the abnormal spot.